Welcome back to Green Mountain Mornings on WKVT 100.3 FM, AM 1490, Brattleboro's News Talk Station. It is 8:22 on the clock and negative 4 degrees out there on this January 2nd of 2018. And also, this is the fun part of this morning. I want to introduce Harmony Birch from The Reformer. Hello, Harmony. So Harmony and I will be talking today about local news. This conversation is also being filmed by folks at Brattleboro Community Television. And broadcast of Green Mountain Mornings tonight on BCTV is sponsored by Brattleboro Savings and Loan. You can find this video on brattleboro.tv later today. So welcome, Harmony. Tell us about, we've kind of been in a little bit of a la-la land lately between holidays and New Year's, but there's been a number of fires in the area. Tell us about those.
One, at least two last week that I covered. One was in a trailer community and in Hinsdale, and the other was in Wilmington. So yeah, essentially what I've heard from firefighters is a lot of it has to do with pipes freezing and the ways that people try to warm those pipes.
Okay.
It's also just a high risk season because of things like heated blankets and what are these things called? The personal heaters.
Oh, space heaters.
Space heaters. Yes.
Foot warmers, you can also call them.
Yes. So all of those things kind of make it a little bit more prone for fires is my understanding. But then it's also kind of awful for firefighters because when you go out and these below freezing temperatures, you risk having the fire truck itself freeze.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah. So did the firefighters share with you sort of the best ways to defrost your pipes versus the not best ways to defrost your pipes should they freeze?
I mean, I don't know if they were experts on the matter, but I talked to one volunteer fire chief, volunteer fire chief of Wilmington, and he told me that people sometimes like go there and just try to heat them, like take an open flame to the outside of their pipes. And yeah. I would imagine that is not the best way. I know very little about how pipes freezing. I just know that you need to have it on like 50 degrees, your heat at all times to avoid that.
Mm-hmm.
So I did not ask a lot of questions about that, but there seems to be some things that breach common sense for me that people have been trying to do.
I understand. I hear you. Yeah, some of the tips I've always heard is keep your cabinets open.
Oh.
So that as much warm air from the room can circulate around the pipes as possible. And yeah, don't use open flames. In general, using open flame is not such a great idea. But yeah, I've been hearing from fire departments too that now is a time when a lot of fires, the amount of fires tend to increase because people are having to get a little creative with keeping their house warm and their pipes thawed.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is a difficult time of year. You also covered, and you and Chris Mays covered a recent tragedy in Whitingham.
Yes, so Chris Mays probably did the majority of the coverage on this, but it happened Saturday morning, I believe. And a man from Reedsboro ended up driving into the reservoir in Whitingham.
Mm-hmm.
And police and dive teams were called out and firefighters, and they did end up finding his body. And only one body was found, lost to my knowledge. But it is really tragic. And I don't know. We have all these crashes going on, so people just drive slow, I guess.
I received a number of reports this morning about crashes over the weekend. And many of them, it's just driving along and you think the road's fine. And then all of a sudden you're in the ditch.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't. And so, yes, slow down. Always a good reminder. What about in Rockingham? You just had, there's been two changes in staff, but let's start with the resignation.
Okay, so municipal manager Shane O'Keefe, he decided to end his contract at June 30th, which is what he was contracted for anyway, but there were a lot of talks, I guess, before this of maybe extending his contract.
Okay.
And this is happening during when the joint board has been going, which is the select board and the trustee board, has been going into a lot of executive sessions, I assume, and it's kind of implied by people talking around about managing the manager, essentially. So every year, the manager gets reviewed by these boards to kind of like give job performances. And it seems like that is what they have been doing. They've been talking about it a little bit outside of executive session and hinting at like that's what they're doing. So it seems as though they're managing the manager, and now he has decided, hey, it's okay. You don't need to update my contract. I'm just going to leave.
Interesting. How long has he been there again?
It's about a year.
Okay.
Yeah. I think he started in November. So I think it's a little bit over a year.
And when you say managing the manager, and of course, this is executive session, so there's a lot you can't comment on. Does it seem they were unhappy with his job performance? They wanted to change his job description? Has anyone commented on that?
Different select board members and trustees have commented, not necessarily on the municipal manager himself or his character, but on various things that they might like to change about the way that the town has run. But this is a general thing that happens every year to municipal managers. It's just, the role is, you know, like the municipal manager is there to do the bidding of the trustees and the select board. So every year they do like a job performance review, as I'm sure most people have done. So it's really just like a job performance review, but it's a big to-do because it's such an important role.
Right.
And both boards have to be in on it.
Well, thank you, Harmony. Harmony and I will continue talking about Rockingham after the break. Welcome back to Green Mountain Mornings on WKVT 100.3 FM, AM 1490, Brattleboro's news talk station. For -4 degrees out there and 8:39 on this Tuesday, January 2nd of 2018. I have to keep reminding myself, yes, we are in 2018. I'm your host, Olga Peters, and welcome back to my guest, Harmony Birch from The Reformer. Hello, Harmony.
Hello.
And before the break, we were talking about some changes in Rockingham.
Mm-hmm.
One was the town manager.
Yep.
Is it town manager or town administrator? I'm sorry.
It's town manager. He's the municipal manager, technically, because he's town and village.
Oh, that's quite a role. I didn't realize he bridged both. But they also just hired a new finance director.
Yes, they did.
So tell me about that.
So the finance director position had been open for about a year, and that was a little bit troubling because the finance director, like the municipal manager, does handle both town and village finances. And you could say maybe there might have been a correlation with some of the financial struggles that Bells Falls experienced this year and the fact that there was no financial manager to help make some of those critical budgeting decisions. But we finally got one. He's not going to be handling the 2019 fiscal year budget because he did just come on and budget season is fast approaching. So the municipal manager, Shane O'Keefe, has taken that upon himself. But there is finally a town manager and or a financial manager, and he is learning the system and the ropes. And I think it's a great thing because Rockingham and Bellows Falls really needed a financial manager. So hopefully this will help them better determine what budgets they need in the future. His name is Ronald Karvasky, and he worked at Hubbard Farms. And so they went away in 2016 down to Tennessee, and he decided not to move with them. He wanted to stay in New Hampshire. Mm-hmm. He also has some municipal experience or some like governance experience because he was a selectman.
Okay.
In Marlow, New Hampshire. And he did that for quite a few years. And he has various other like CPA experiences. He's done CPA on like by himself.
Mm-hmm.
CPA work, like contracting before. But this is his first time working in the public sector rather than the private sector.
Oh, that'll be an interesting transition. And what a unique position to be managing the finances for a village and a municipality that are kind of folded into each other.
Yeah.
That's going to be a fascinating learning curve for him. More power to him.
Yeah. I think his main obstacle right now is simply like learning the system, but it is a little bit different because of the fund balances and just the way municipal budgeting works in general. But he seems pretty confident in that he will get it.
Do you, and I'm totally asking you your opinion, so.
It's dangerous.
Dangerous. I realize I'm walking a tightrope here. You know, the village of Bellows Falls has been wrestling with its budget over this past year. Do you think not having a financial manager may have made that struggle a little worse? Or was it completely a whole different arena?
I think it definitely didn't help. Not that the municipal manager and the finance office themselves, and they contracted out with different people too. Mm-hmm. Like, I believe there was a lot of care put into the original proposed budget for Bellows Falls. But I think that had they had a financial manager there, it would have given the people more, like, trust in that budget.
Hmm.
Or maybe the budget could have done better, like, because they didn't have one expert. And it did really strain resources. Rockingham Select Board members have voiced the fact that they felt like the municipal manager, for instance, because he kind of had to operate partially in the finance director right. role while this was going on, has been too focused on Bellows Falls because so much is going on there and not giving them enough attention. So I do think that it would have put less strain on the entirety of the staff. And yeah, it would have given the people more reason to trust in what was going on.
Thank you for that, Harmony. You know, one reason I was thinking about that is, you know, so many of us, I think we look at municipal budgets as operating kind of like personal budgets, and they really don't. They're much more intricate. They need much more kind of 65,000 foot views. And someone who really can say, this is good debt. This is not good debt. This is a deficit. This is a good deficit. You know, there's like all these little ins and outs that just don't happen in a personal budget.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. You had a couple stories on the website that I found interesting about this year in review, looking back at 2018. And one of them was Santa's Land, I believe.
Yes. So I've written about Santa's Land a lot this year. And we had various writers who wrote about it before I came on. But I was really excited and felt very special to get to write about Santa's Land when it eventually did open finally this year, because I went there once when I was six and it was a life-changing experience.
It's one of my vivid childhood memories too, yes.
Yeah. But Santa's Land finally opened after 3 years of being closed, and it was reopened by this man named David Haversat, who, as many of you might know, is a magician from Connecticut.
So cool.
I know. It's just like a magical tale. And he did a bunch of things. He added a bunch of animatronics. He added a new carousel. And he just really cleaned up the park, which was, before it opened, really in bad shape. There was some vandalism that happened. And it just hadn't been maintained for those 3 years that I think it probably hadn't been maintained for even longer than the 3 years, because there were some issues with the previous temporary owners in relation to animal abuse. And I think there was just kind of some neglect on the park in general. But he went and he kind of with the help of various other community members, but mostly by himself, cleaned up this entire park and opened it. And it's just, I don't know, it's a magical story. Everyone in Putney seems to have been going now, and now it's open. And some people are a little bit unsatisfied. There's no animals, there's no pancake house, but like, for what he had, he really kind of pulled together this scrappy little invention. And it looks really nice. It does seem very magical. There were select board members who got to go there during the ribbon cutting. And last I heard, I mean, it's closed now. It won't be open again until May. It seems to be doing pretty okay financially. Mm-hmm. I think there's definitely going to be a loss this year because he just invested so much. But, right, you know, every day that he was open, people seem to be waiting to come in. So.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, I think Santa's Land has been around for so many decades. It's part of a lot of people's childhoods in this area.
Yeah, it's been around for six decades.
Oh my gosh. Wow. I got the impression reading your pieces that the new owner, he seems, actually this is smart, it seems like he's kind of starting small, and as the park grows and his visitorship grows, he will expand things. So we may actually get the pancake house back or something like that.
It may not be the pancake house, but yes, I definitely think that is. I think it's a matter of resources right now, mm-hmm, because it is a big endeavor to simply buy a theme park. Like, I don't think this man is necessarily rich. I think this has just been his dream, and right, he's invested and thought about this for a while. But yeah, it's a big endeavor to find a theme park and then clean it up and then open it. And he's doing this basically all by himself. There is help, and there's a lot of people who offered free resources and a lot of community members who helped out as well. But it's a lot for one person, one financial backer.
Yeah. So the park reopens in May?
Yes, it will reopen in late May.
Okay. Well, we all have to line up. Late May, you and I.
Yes, I'm ready.
We're there. Any topics in 2018 that, or issues that you will be following closely?
So I'm definitely, I just wrote a story. It hasn't been published yet, about the Greater Falls Connections, mm-hmm, which is located in Bellows Falls, asking the town of Rockingham for some aid to keep their program going. And that, to me, is a really interesting story. It's kind of a small subset of the larger piece, being that Rockingham seems as though it might have higher taxes this year because they need to get a lot of like sidewalk stuff done and a lot of roadway stuff. There's a lot of projects that the town has continually been putting off, and it's getting to the point where they really just can't put it off anymore. And the state is making certain regulations telling them they have to do certain things.
Oh, interesting.
And Rockingham being close to Bellows Falls, being a part of the same municipality, I myself am interested to see what happens and how the taxpayers respond and if it will be similar to Bellows Falls. But Greater Falls Connections, which isn't asking for a lot of money, they're asking for $4,000. That is an interesting piece to me because that's a very small organization, but it does so much in that community because there are a lot of problems with opioid abuse. And Greater Falls Connections, what it does is really focuses on the youth of the community and education around prevention of any sorts of drugs or alcohol or smoking.
Mm-hmm.
So that just, I personally think that seems like a really important part for the community. And having covered it for even just like the little bit that I've been here, it seems like that is an organization that gets brought up a lot and seems to be important to a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
And if they don't get this $4,000, eventually they have a couple more years to try and obtain it. But right now they're going off of a federal grant that was given to them. And that's like really their main and only source of income. They don't really get donations. You can donate, of course, but it's a 3-person staff and they're doing a lot. And they're not in donations. That's not what they're doing. So they're working entirely off of a grant that expires in 2021.
Mm-hmm.
And if they don't find some sort of sustainable funding source, then they won't have that staff. So they have it's 3 years now, right? Because we're in 2018. So they have 3 years to kind of figure out some sort of sustainable funding source to keep the program going. And I feel like there's going to be more things like that going on in Rockingham.
Okay. And so it sounds like that intersection between infrastructure, community services, and what the taxpayers can actually bear.
Yeah.
I think that's an issue a lot of Vermont communities look at a lot, but we'll be looking at more.
Yeah.
Especially if wages stay kind of stagnant where they're staying.
Well, today, didn't the minimum wage get raised?
I believe it did.
So we'll see. But then there's that whole issue with small business owners. But that's another thing that will be interesting to see in 2018, how the minimum wage being raised is affecting our small communities.
Mm-hmm. Good point. I'm making a note on that.
So that will definitely also be something we probably look into. And then just kind of keeping our tabs on the opioid crisis, mm-hmm. which is an ongoing issue in Vermont.
Yeah, it's interesting. In some ways, it hasn't, in the last few months, gotten the same amount of play as maybe it did at the beginning of 2017. But it certainly hasn't gone away.
No, I think we're becoming a little bit more desensitized. And also, I mean, as a journalist, like at the beginning, well, no, I wasn't here at the beginning of 2017, but I was here during the July 4th incident,
mm-hmm.
and I was the one that covered it. But I haven't seen a lot of press releases going out about mass overdoses like that. So
right.
I don't know if that's on the police, because we don't generally cover overdoses unless it's something big like that.
Mm-hmm. But I think your point is good, and we'll have to leave it there because of time. But you're right. We have to be careful what we become desensitized to.
Yeah.
Because doesn't mean it's gone away. Well, thank you so much, Harmony, for being in the studio with me today.
Thank you.
And I look forward to having you back in 2 weeks, I believe.
Yeah.